Hello, my name is Dr. Darin Woolpert, and I am from California State University, San Marcos in the United States, presenting the relationship of narrative production to reading comprehension. This is a systematic review of the available research on this topic, and it ties to UN Sustainable Development Goal number 4 regarding quality education. I'm going to start at the end with the take-home message, and then I'm going to explain how I got to this point and circle around to it again. So there's an important distinction that I want to make between narrative production, which does not appear to be important for reading, and narrative structure, which does. And I'm going to talk about that a little bit more in a moment. But first, I wanted to take a step back to talk about the central problem, which is that reading is hard for many children worldwide. And that's important because understanding what you read is critical for both academic and professional success, especially in a digital era like this one. So what can we do about this problem? Well, one thing we can do is look at spoken language development, because reading is built on a foundation of spoken language. And if we work on stories, by which I mean narratives, when children are young, for example, in the preschool age, we might be able to put them in a better position to develop literacy when formal instruction of reading begins at school age. As far as connecting narratives to reading and why we think these things are related, for decades now, the research has suggested things such as narrative production is the single most important language ability for success in school. Now, this is a very strong claim, and I don't know that anyone would make it today. But there are certainly many studies that say things like narrative production is highly predictive of reading comprehension. So what do we mean by narratives? Well, narratives are culturally universal, you know, across the globe and throughout history. But this storytelling register is different than conversation. In English, we have many children's stories that begin once upon a time. And that's different than the way people normally speak to each other in casual conversation. And so what that means is that there's a special kind of language that's used in narratives that children won't get familiar with just from overhearing casual conversation. Also, narratives have many parts that can be analyzed and researched. And one of the ones that we're going to focus on today is narrative structure. And it's generally studied as Western narrative structure, which has a conventional structure of a setting, and then some kind of a problem to be overcome, and then some sort of resolution or ending. So that's what we mean by narrative structure. And that's going to be the important part to keep track of. In terms of reading comprehension, we can look at something called the simple view of reading, which is a framework that says decoding ability, and I'll talk about that in a moment, times oral comprehension ability gives you reading comprehension, the ability to understand what you read. And when we talk about decoding, I often like to bring up hieroglyphics and this idea of seeing a visual symbol and trying to connect that to some sort of linguistic concept that you might already know. For example, this looks like a beetle, this looks like a bird. And so being able to access that information is important from a decoding perspective, but it's not the whole picture because there's a lot more going on here. And if you don't understand the whole thing, then it's not as important that you're able to decode, because you're still not going to be able to understand what you're reading. I'm going to pause for a moment here just to mention my own personal science adventure, how I got into this area of research. which was based on looking at some of the studies that I mentioned before that say there's a clear relationship between narrative production and reading comprehension. And I set out to carry out one of those studies on my own, and it didn't work out the way I expected. And Isaac Asimov says the most exciting phrase to hear in science is not "Eureka, I found it," but rather, "That's funny. There's something strange here." And there is something strange in my results that caused me to go back to the research and explore further. And one of the things that I realized is it's not totally clear where narrative production fits into models of reading comprehension. So this, of course, is a more complex model than the simple view framework, but I will point out that it has language comprehension as one component, and then word recognition, which is very similar to decoding and just incorporates a few other aspects as well. And there is nothing in the research that suggests that decoding is going to be helped by improving narrative ability. So we'll put that aside for now, and instead we'll focus on language comprehension. When we look at the different skills that are meant to support language comprehension, we see literacy knowledge contains this piece about genre, and that includes narratives, but it also includes expositories like making a speech or writing an essay. And so that is a possibility, but this is comprehension, and I was very interested in and focused on narrative production. And any foreign language speaker can tell you that it is very different to understand a language than it is to produce that language. I think we've all had that experience. So I conducted a systematic review. I looked across as many studies as I could find. I cast a very broad net and had nearly 4,000 studies to start with. And then I removed duplicates. I screened ones that seemed irrelevant. And then of the ones that seemed like good potential matches, there were many that were missing some important element for what I wanted to study. And that left us with 12 studies. Along the way, we found 7 extra studies, and we included those in the review. And I will mention as well that of the 44 studies that met eligibility for the larger study, I'm only going to have time to focus on these 12 RCTs, or randomized control trials, which are some of the strongest research evidence that we have available to us. So, what I found is that there were 8 randomized control trials that related narrative structure to reading comprehension and specifically providing an intervention, a treatment to children, targeting narrative structure, and then measuring how it affected reading comprehension. And in 7 of 8 studies, there was a benefit with effect sizes ranging from 0.49 to 1.48. And that's a fairly strong range of effect sizes. There were 4 other studies that were not just looking at narrative structure, but instead were looking at narrative production more broadly, and they did not appear to help reading comprehension. I will note that all of them contained other aspects of language in the interventions that were provided to the children, but they did contain a narrative production element. And as far as I could find in my systematic review, these were the only other randomized control trials that we had available to us that met the criteria for inclusion in the study. So this first study in preschoolers did not find a benefit. This study in school-aged children did find a benefit to reading comprehension, but this one and this one did not. And so in sum, looking across these studies, we have only one out of 4 that indicated that broad narrative production abilities help reading comprehension. So, narrative structure has a clear benefit, but of course, I am presenting this in a simplified way, and I do want to make it clear that there's context and caveats to that that are important, and you can read them here. In addition, narrative production, there were the 4 studies that we looked at, and we didn't see evidence of a benefit, but this is specific to reading comprehension. There is value to being able to produce a narrative in and of itself. But if what you care about is improving reading comprehension, and you're hoping to use narrative intervention to accomplish that, which is something that many educational professionals do, you really want to focus on the narrative structure piece rather than the narrative production. And hopefully by now you understand why this is the take-home message and this distinction between narrative production generally and narrative structure in particular is important, because only one of those two seems to help with reading comprehension. I wanted to say thank you for coming and viewing my presentation today. I wanted to acknowledge Dr. Dana Battetti for some of her help with the study. Here is my email address and my Twitter. I would love to hear from you if you have questions about the study or if you're interested in more information. And because this is a video presentation, I can imagine questions that might be asked and then prepare answers for them ahead of time. For example, how should this information be used? And you can pause the video and read my response here. Isn't there value in narrative ability itself? And absolutely, the answer is yes to that. But again, if you're interested in reading comprehension, then don't look at narrative production broadly. What databases were searched? These were the places that I searched, and these are some of the search terms that I used. In terms of more recent models of reading, yeah, this one is more complex even than the one we looked at before, but you still have a problem of trying to figure out where narrative production would fit in all of this. And there are definitely limitations of this study, as there are with any study. But I have information addressing some of those potential concerns. So thank you again for viewing my presentation, and I hope you have a nice day.